morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to First Baptist Church of Sutton and our 1 year anniversary celebration for the restart and relaunch with Pastor Don McKinnon. We're happy that you're here today. We're here to worship. We're standing on holy ground, and that's where we're going to start this morning. We're just going to lift our voices, just our voices. We are standing on holy ground, and I know that there are angels all around. Let us pray.
Remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory,
may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, having the hearts of your eyes enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his great might that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in heavenly places. And the other scripture I'm going to read is from Ephesians 3, 14 through 20. And again, Paul is speaking to the Ephesian church. Prayer for spiritual strength. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and earth is named, that according to the riches of glory, he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Holy Spirit in your inner being, so that in love you may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, the length, the height, and the depth, to know the love of Christ which surpasses knowledge, and that you may be filled with the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever. So let it be our prayer that God continues to send a fresh wind, a fresh fire, and a fresh awakening in each and every one of us as we move forward. Let's be excited about what God is doing here. Trust in God that what he starts, he will bring to completion. And we will be a church that will be that shining light for this community and the surrounding communities. Thank you.
Amen.
Amen.
You bring it on. God is good, and we have been through those hills and valleys over a 1 year period. Even within a few months of starting, God has brought us through struggles, personal struggles, and all that. And this song that we're going to start with this morning just speaks to that. So stand as we worship.
Battleground, see just how much you've done, knowing every victory.
the Lord in prayer as we celebrate 1 year. 1 year ago, actually, it would be 1 year ago next Sunday that I came, but it's a year. This is the 365 or 366, depending if it's the year, day that we have. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your son who sacrificed himself so that we can be a part of your family here, Father. We thank you that you have brought us all here safely to hear your message that you are going to give today. I pray that your spirit would just flow through me. I pray that your spirit would just be poured out here as we just celebrate a year, Father, and also look forward to more of the future as we revitalize and restore what was here and what has been here. Father, we just ask that you would just open up our hearts and minds to what is said and just be with us. We ask this all right now in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. So, I'm going to have my phone up here, not because of time, because I have a clock right there, but I still haven't gotten the ink for my printer, so I'm still kind of being semi-cool using my Kindle for the notes, and it turned off while I was over here. But let me ask you a question. So, we've all seen cars being restored. It is an awesome thing. For me as a guy, I love seeing old cars. Natalie, I know she likes seeing it because that's something that her and her grandfather used to hang out and do, go to these car shows. Maybe you've gone to a diner and you see that this old diner has this classic car in it. And you see these beautifully restored cars. Some of them are showroom, like they're like they just came out of the Chevy dealership from 50, 60, 70 years ago. Maybe some of them have been remodified, like, you know, certain colors, or the roof's been cut a little bit to make it lower, you know, so almost looks like the guy's driving a tank, you know, like the windshield's like that. Other times, you might see something like this, you know. Somebody's driven their car there, and it's, you know, it's a classic, but they've got maybe some brown or gray or black primer all on this vehicle. And maybe for yourself, you're kind of scratching your head like, why is this here? It's not done. It's a process. And one thing that we are in is in a process. We're like that car that's in there. And we've slapped some Bondo and some primer on some things. We're still going forward. We're still not there. I mean, a lot of these guys that drive those cars, they're happy. They've got something that they're looking forward to. They have a plan for it. They know that it's going to be there soon. But it's going to take time. It's going to take years before it's completely done. But why not show off what you've already done? We have to remember that it doesn't take overnight for a big car to be restored. I mean, yeah, we could easily take the car or bring it to Mako and do their, you know, $444 paint thing and get it, but it's not going to be the type of paint job we want. It's not going to be something like if we take it to that guy that specializes in that color and that style and that gloss that you want. You know, Mako's just made to make it look pretty, but the auto body specialist, he's going to make it look really nice. it reminds us of what Paul says to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. The old is past, behold, the new has come. For these cars, they're basically, these classic cars, they become like new cars. The people have invested money, they've made the motors run just like they did out of the factory. They've maybe modified it. They've maybe added their own things. The car's a little more gas efficient or something, but these cars, these guys have taken time to restore them, to put them to good use. And today, we're going to talk about what God has done. And this is going to be kind of a hard sermon to preach in some ways, but I just want you to know that what I'm saying here, God placed on my heart months ago. Because God wants us to continue moving forward. God has done a lot of great things over the last year. We've seen prayers answered. We've seen miracles happen. And there's more that God wants to do here. One thing that God says is that He wants to restore to us our lost years. This is what He writes in Joel. Now, a lot of this is written. I know we're used to maybe an exegetical. We've been going through the Gospel of Mark. So, for me, this is a little bit out of my comfort zone. But this is, we're going to have a few verses that we're going to focus on. This is the first one. This is Joel 2:25 through 26. And this is what he says. I will restore to you the years that the swarming locust has eaten, the hopper, the destroyer, and the cutter, the mighty great army which I sent among you. You shall eat in plenty and be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God, just like we sang. And my people shall never again be put to shame. So what happens is we can become obsessed with the past. We can be asking ourselves constantly the what ifs. What if we did this? What if we did that? What if this person did this? What if that person did that? And it becomes a hard game to play. It becomes a game that's dangerous because we can focus too much on the past and never look forward to the future, never look past our past and look at what God is trying to do for us in the future. We have to remember that we have to be continually moving forward. And when God promises something, He's going to do it. The story of Job is one of those things. Job sits there, and he is this righteous man of God. He's been blessed. He has family. He has livestock. He has homes. He's got, like, everything possible. And Satan goes up to heaven one day and says to the Lord, he says, you know what, if you take all that away, the man you know, the righteous man you know is Job, he's just going to curse you and die. God takes Satan up on this bargain. He says, go ahead. But you can't kill him, but you can do what you want. So he goes on. He loses his kids. He loses his homes. He loses his livestock, his livelihood. Everything is taken away from him. His health is taken away from him. He gets the boils all over his body. That it says he has to take this shard of glass and spray it. Because it is just nasty. And through it all, he does not curse God. Through it all, he realizes God is in charge. And if this is God's way, then there's something better that's going to come out of it. And sure enough, later, God comes down and admonishes, you know, basically yells at Job's friends who are trying to comfort him. And then he gives everything back to Job. He gives him back his family, his money, his livelihood, his homes, his livestock. Everything is back. And you see, we can be focused on that here. We can be focused on that here. What we had in the past. Now, it's good to focus on certain things in the past. It's good to focus on the positive history of the past. But we have to remember that our past does not define us. In other words, the bad stuff does not define us. And when we think that it does, when people out there in Sutton and the surrounding communities think about the bad stuff, we have to remember we are holding on to this. I will restore. We have to stop thinking about the past and start creating the new legacy and the new history that God has been giving to us. We are not a people of the past. We are a people of the future. We are here because the future of this church is on us. God has placed us here as the future of the church. As more people come in, we give them the positive things. We tell them about how God miraculously provided the money for a brand new furnace downstairs. We tell them about how Lindsay was healed after falling. We show that positively to the people instead of worrying about what happened to our past. God also says that he's going to restore his name. Behold, I have refined you, but not as silver. I have tried you in the furnace of affliction for my own sake. For my own sake. He repeats that twice. That's like, you know, whatever there is in Hebrew, in the Middle East, whenever something repeats something, that's like kind of like, you get it. This is true. Okay? For my sake. For my sake. God is saying, for my sake, I do it. For how should my name be profaned? My glory I will not give to another. So when people are trying to bring up the past here, what has happened in the past, we've got to remember that we are living for a living God. And he's going to lift us up and he's going to restore us. Why? For his name's sake. Our past does not define us. God defines us. And he will restore us. We need to be better, not bitter, about the past. We need to keep going forward. We need to keep driving towards that goal. How a person carries themselves speaks volumes to those around them. So in other words, you ever see that very positive guy that's like really excited? Like, let me tell you something, I gotta do it. And you're like all of a sudden you just feel that energy like come on to you. And some people get turned off by the energy, but other people, they're like, wow, I really like this guy. I really like this person. Oh, it's doing insane. That's how we've got to be out there. We've got to be positive. We've got to be telling people what is going on here. One thing that Dr. Mark Clifton says, a suffering church does not bring glory to God, but a church that is thriving, even in the small things, and sharing that out into its community speaks volumes. It shouts to the people that God is real and that God is doing things. A hurting, dying, warring within church, none of that brings glory to God. When a church is living for God and showing his love to our neighbors, the very ones that we may be judging us for the past, everything that's gone on, those are the people that we can reach by just going across the street, shoveling them out, mowing the lawn, giving them water, whatever. They're going to sit there and those past things that they might be judging what was who and what the people here previously did, they're going to realize that something's going on, that they've had it wrong, that God is doing something. And he's already done that. Like I said, he's already showed up here in the last year. He's already been doing stuff to prove to us that he is not done with First Baptist yet. He has answered prayers, and he's going to continue to answer those prayers going forward. Third point. God is going to restore our health. Now, I'm not talking about human health. All right? Human health is one thing. We can take our health for granted at times, us as humans. We can sit there and, you know, maybe that pain, I can just work past it. That pain is telling us something. And when we go to the doctor, we get the diagnosis that we didn't want to hear, and we wonder how our lives are going to change and how the lives of our family and friends is going to change. God, though, when he talks about the health of the church, of his people, he's talking about restoring things. So if you look at this, I will restore health to you, and your wounds I will heal, declares the Lord, because they have called you an outcast. It is Zion for whom no one cares. In other words, everything that these people that we think are having out for us here because of the past, God's already changed them. We've already seen that. When we did Chain of Lights, we saw them come in. We saw them love on us, and we loved on them. And that's what we have to keep doing. We can't keep bringing up the past. We have to look past the past. We have to move forward. We have to build on those relationships. We have relationships with two of our neighbors here now. We have one neighbor that's like, hey, if you're serious about doing a movie out back there, I'm going to support you. I'm going to figure out how to help you. That's what we need to realize. That's where God is doing a miracle here. That's where he's building us up. That's where he's restoring us for his name's sake. Not for First Baptist. First Baptist Church is not, should not be what defines us. It should be God. It should be Jesus Christ that defines us. And here's the thing, if we don't start telling people, if we don't start sharing what God is doing, this is what Jesus himself says. Luke 19:40, he says, he answered, I tell you, if these, and these were the disciples that he was talking about, were silent, the very stones would cry out. He's talking with this, with our old friends, the Pharisees. And he's talking with them, and he's telling them, if the disciples who aren't already excited about what God is doing here, if they were to shut up and just button their lips, super glue their lips shut, even the rocks would begin to cry out, glory to God. That's what's happening. Nothing done for man brings glory to God, but what is done for God shows his glory. It brings it to him. So what do we do now? What do we do now? I'm not trying to be a dead downer. I know it seems like, oh, we're celebrating 1 year. I'm not. Like I said, this was a hard thing to preach because we sit here and we're excited about what's going on here, but we need to start looking and closing the door on the negative things of the past. We need to be, because like I said, when we bring in the people, when people come here and they sit there and they say, oh, what's going on here? And why is the door almost shut and stuff? We need to be positive. We need to be saying, God's doing a lot here. That's in the past. You know? We have a positive past. We have Benjamin Marsh, who founded this church almost 300 years ago in 1735. And he led this church for 40 years through the Great Awakening and the beginning of the Revolutionary War. No pastor since him has had that long of tenure. We had two others. One led this church for 29 years, about 40 years after him, and then Ed, Pastor Ed, who led this church for 20 years. That's the tenure. And believe me, if God will have me, I would die in this pulpit. And then whatever my age is at that time, I'd have to be 85 to not God's will, then what I want to do is I want to build up that legacy for God here. I want to be training the next pastor when he comes in to take my place, so that what God is doing here is going to continue. And we won't have these little starts and stops that have pockmarked our history. So what are we going to do? Well, like I said, we're not going to dwell on the past. I've got three verses here I want to show you. Proverbs. It says, whoever conceals his transgressions will not prosper, but he who confesses and forsakes them will obtain mercy. Proverbs 28:13. When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command the locusts to devour the land and send pestilence among my people, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and forgive their sin and heal their land. 2 Chronicles 7:13-14. And then the last one, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from the unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to say this. You see, we are that car that isn't quite restored. We're not that car. We are that car that's not quite restored. We are that car that has the bondo that people wonder why we're driving around in. And it's because, hey, something's going on. We're working towards what God wants. But I'm going to say this. I would be remiss if right now, as your pastor, I did not take the time to do what the priests in Israel did. And what we're going to do is we're going to take a few minutes, and I'm going to pray. For us as a congregation, we are going to forgive the past. We're going to ask God to forgive that past. And from this day forward, going into year two, we are going to march forward to the goal that God has placed here. Restoration, revitalization of a church is a slow process. It takes 5 years, roughly, they say. 5, maybe 6 years. So we're going into year two. We've got the bondo slapped on. We've been doing some good work out here. But the work is still much. And right now, we're just going to do a little more. I'm going to sit here and I'm going to pray for us as a congregation as we forgive what has happened. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you a video. I'm not going to have us down. We're going to have a video that's going to celebrate in 5 minutes what God has done in the last year. All right. Father in heaven, we come before you. Father, we come before you as children, as your children. Father, we know that there has been a history here. There has been positives and negatives. And Father, the positives have brought glory to you, but the negatives, they haven't, and they've brought us down. Father, we hold true to your word. We hold true that you will do something. And so, Father, I ask on behalf of these people, we forgive those in the past that have done wrong, whether it's to us or to members of the past. Father, we ask for your mercy. We ask for your strength to be able to do this. Father, we forgive them because it is your command that we forgive those who have done us wrong. And so, Father, we just ask that you would be faithful to your word. Forgive those people as we are forgiving those people. And then let us start to see your light, your glory return here. You are already doing things, Father, We are going to shout that from the steepletops, from the hilltops, from the mountaintops. Father, you have done things that when we have shared with people, they have been surprised at what's going on. From the fact that this building should not stand here because of the furnace, but to the fact also that we have seen people healed, we have seen miracles happen, we have seen jobs provided, we have seen so much over this year, Father. And we just pray that we would continue to see that we would continue to see growth, Father, that you would continue to do things. Father, be with us as we celebrate, as we go forward today. Let your praise be on our lips. Let us not go back to what was, but let us continue to move forward. Let us continue looking to the positives that you've done and what that means for the future here, for what you are doing here. And Father, I just ask that you would just be with us and bless us as we continue on with our service. Jesus.
You're the God of this city, you're the King of these people, you're the Lord of this nation, you are. You're the light in this darkness, you're the hope to the hopeless, you're the peace to the restless, you are. There is no one like our God. Is no one like our God. For greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. You're the God of this city, you're the King of this people, you're the Lord of this nation, you are. You're the light in this darkness, you're the hope to the hopeless, you're the peace to the restless, you are. There is no one like I. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done. our God. There is no one like you, God. For greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done. We believe, in you, God. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. For greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done here. Father in heaven, we thank you for this time. We thank you for last year and all that we saw, what you've done, answered prayers, growth that you've given each and every one of us. I thank you for that as the pastor. I thank you for that. Seeing it in myself and I just ask that you would just help us as we prepare to take and remember why we are here. Father, we thank you for your Son who died on the cross for our sins. And Father, as we celebrate with the Lord's Supper today, we just ask that you would just prepare our hearts. Father, be with us. Let us take worthy of this element. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. How great the pain of
Oh!